Thank you for joining us today. I'm Kelly Heim, and I'm very happy to have the opportunity to present on berberine, which is an interesting compound that many of you may have already heard about. Many of you may have already used it in clinical practice and are interested in learning how it can be used in an evidence-based fashion for cardiometabolic applications. So before I begin, I'd like to disclose that I am a paid employee of Pure Encapsulations. I do not have any other conflicts of interest to disclose, and my opinions do not necessarily reflect those of the company. So just a quick overview of what we'll cover today. First, I'll touch on the history and traditional use of berberine, and then we'll go into the top three evidence-based indications: glucose, lipids, and vascular health. And then we'll talk about the mechanisms of action, the pharmacodynamics, and the pharmacokinetics, and some limitations in the bioavailability of this compound and how to overcome that. And then we'll end with some safety and drug interaction information. Berberine is a quaternary alkaloid that is found predominantly in a genus of species called the Berberis species. So this is actually a genus of over 300 different plants. And berberine is actually pretty rare in the plant kingdom. Its botanical occurrence is restricted to mainly that genus. And one of the most familiar members of the genus would be golden seal and some of the other herbs in Chinese medicine, like Coptis chinensis. So berberis is a species of plants that makes berberine. So berberine doesn't really occur anywhere else. You may have come across it quite frequently in the supplements marketplace, but we really don't ingest this compound through the diet. It was first isolated in 1917 from golden seal. So it's been around for quite some time, but its use in medicine is fairly new. So I'll talk about the studies, the research behind berberine, how it works, so you can get everything you need in terms of how to understand how to use it in clinical practice safely and effectively. Just a brief history. You know, again, berberine as an isolated substance is fairly new, but the plants that contain berberine have been in use for thousands of years. So the use of the berberine-containing plants dates back to 650 BC. The emperor of Assyria in the ancient Middle East had these clay tablets in his library that described the use of berberis and berberine-containing plants for medicinal purposes. And then in Chinese medicine and Ayurveda, the use of berberine-containing plants dates back 3,000 years. And mainly the indications were gastrointestinal, immune-related, and metabolic. And then in South America, in Chile and Argentina, the use of berberine-containing plants was very common. And one of the indications was tolerating the altitude. And although berberine itself is not known to do that, the plants that contain this compound were used for that purpose. So the use in that area of the world dates back quite some time as well. Today, berberine is typically marketed as a sulfate or a chloride salt. There are some other forms of berberine like bromide. There are some additional ways you can conjugate berberine to make it stable in a solid dosage format. Most of the berberine that is described in the medical literature is the berberine chloride or the berberine hydrochloride. And all the studies I'll be talking about today administered berberine hydrochloride. If you collect all of the current publications on berberine, you'll find that there are 65 clinical trials, human clinical trials, using berberine hydrochloride as a single agent. There are quite a few reviews, meta-analyses. There are about 1,200 animal studies that have been published to date, and there's a wealth of in vitro data that informs some of the mechanistic information that I will talk about later in this lecture. So let's just break down the clinical trials and what they focused on. Insulin and glucose homeostasis are the main focus of berberine research. There are 18 different human clinical trials using berberine as a single oral agent to support insulin and glucose homeostasis and promote healthy glucose responses. Overwhelmingly, the results of these trials have been positive. Another interesting area of berberine research focuses on the gastrointestinal tract and the microbiota. And berberine is known to modify the microbiota in the GI tract, and that is one of the leading hypotheses as far as how berberine might be executing its beneficial cardiovascular and metabolic effects. The third area of focus is cardiovascular health and lipid profiles, and we'll talk about some of that research in more detail. Some clinical trials have addressed liver health. Quite a few have kind of gone pretty deep into the pharmacokinetic issues with berberine. Berberine bioavailability is very low, so there are some studies exploring ways to get around that. And then finally, drug interactions are an important area because berberine is an unusual compound. It's an alkaloid. It has a nitrogen atom in it. We don't really come across these types of molecules in the dietary supplement space very often. And it does have the capability to directly interact with P450 enzymes that metabolize various medications. And I'll talk about the drug interactions when we get to the end. So let's go into some of the evidence-based interactions with the focus on cardiometabolic indications that are shown here. So berberine has been studied primarily to support glucose responses, and promoting a healthy glucose response is one of the main reasons why you would want to consider using berberine in practice. Another indication is lipid profile, and then thirdly, vascular health. So these three areas pretty much sum up metabolic health and cardiometabolic health, which affects a very large percentage of the US population. So berberine has a variety of mechanisms that converge on supporting healthy glucose responses. And one of those mechanisms is supporting the expression of the actual insulin receptor itself. So this was a study that found that berberine supports the expression of the insulin receptor in a variety of different human cell lines in a dose response manner. So this is one of the many lines of evidence that shows that berberine actually supports the function of the receptor, the expression and function of the receptor. And then when they gave berberine to humans in this study, they found that the percentage of blood cells that expressed insulin receptors increased with supplementation. So in essence, berberine is helping that insulin receptor to present itself at the membrane and be there when it's needed, so that it can help the body better respond to the glucose that's floating around in the bloodstream. So this may explain why the evidence overwhelmingly supports the fact that berberine supports this healthy glucose response. And here you can see in the open circles, fasting blood glucose, and in the dark circles, postprandial blood glucose. This was a small study of 36 subjects. They received 500 milligrams of berberine 3 times daily for 6 months. And the study found just within 1 week, there was a significant favorable effect on the glucose response. So the effect can be appreciated within a couple of weeks after a supplement is started. You don't necessarily have to wait many weeks or months to wait, you know, to see a benefit. This was a single arm study of 12 women. This actually used a form of berberine that's better absorbed than other forms of berberine. And on the left, the HOMA index is a way of measuring how well insulin is working. The insulin that's already in your body, how well is it actually working? And they found that after 60 days of supplementation with this phytosome, which we'll talk about later, there was a significant benefit as far as how insulin was actually working. And then on the right, there was also an improvement in the amount of insulin that was being produced. So maintaining healthy insulin levels would be another potential benefit of berberine based on this small study. So most of you probably took some courses in medical school or in your allied health education about how insulin and glucose actually work, you know, how insulin supports the disposal of glucose and how that is relevant to managing cardiometabolic health in practice. So let's just take a minute to review that. So a beta cell is one of the cells in the pancreas that releases insulin. So the beta cell releases insulin, and then the insulin binds to its receptor, and this occurs throughout the body, especially in muscle cells, fat cells. It triggers the translocation of glucose transporters, those channels, to the membrane, and that allows glucose to enter the cell. So this is basically how glucose gets into cells. It needs insulin to be released. It also needs insulin to bind to its receptor and enlist a signaling transduction pathway that causes these glucose transporters to get to the membrane and allow glucose to enter the cell. So there are a variety of things that can go wrong here, and a poor diet will typically trigger a reduction in insulin sensitivity. So the actual receptor won't work as well once it's bound. Berberine tends to work in both of these different areas, including the release of insulin from the beta cell. So we'll talk about this, and then we'll also touch on the second mechanism by which berberine supports the actual uptake of glucose by supporting the insulin receptor function. So in mice, if you take out a certain potassium channel, which is located in the pancreas, if you genetically knock it out, the mice no longer respond to berberine. Their glucose levels don't change if you give them berberine. So it just doesn't work as well. So this finding led to this hypothesis that this interesting compound is actually supporting the release of insulin from the pancreas through this potassium channel. So how might that work? This is a close-up of the beta cell in the pancreas, and insulin release is dependent on the membrane depolarizing. And that membrane depolarization is regulated by this potassium channel. So researchers found that berberine actually binds to this potassium channel and causes it to close. And when it closes, the potassium current stops. And that allows the membrane to depolarize, and that encourages the release of insulin. So this is one of the newer mechanisms of action that have appeared in the preclinical literature, suggesting that berberine supports the release of insulin through this potassium channel by direct interaction with it. The Western diet is one of the biggest threats to what you're looking at right here. This delicate system where insulin is bound to its receptor, and that receptor activates glucose transporters. So high calorie diets, high fat and sugar intake, being overweight, will reduce the function of the insulin receptor. And also any kind of oxidative stress or immune activation like inflammation will reduce the ability of that receptor to engage glucose uptake. So interestingly, berberine attacks both of these, and berberine supports the expression of the insulin receptor, as we talked about a moment ago. It also supports the expression of insulin receptor substrate 1, which the receptor needs to activate these transporters and get them to the membrane. It also negatively regulates NF-kappa B, which orchestrates immune activation in the presence of pro-inflammatory cytokines. And this also involves an oxidative stress response that is enhanced through berberine through NRF2, which supports antioxidant defenses. So that mitigates oxidative stress that would also negatively regulate this entire process. So we talked about glucose, let's talk about lipids. So berberine supplementation generally doesn't affect HDL cholesterol. It generally doesn't affect triglycerides. Its main effect is LDL. So this was a study of 80 individuals receiving a dose of 500 milligrams berberine twice daily for 3 months, and there was a significant benefit for LDL cholesterol. So the dosage, even at 500 milligrams twice a day, can also be efficacious in over a three-month period. So if you are using berberine for lipid profile, you want to use a minimum of 1,000 milligrams per day. Ideally, 500 milligrams twice a day would be your minimum dose, and then allow 3 months to reevaluate. But they did this, and they found significant support for healthy lipid profile compared to placebo. And then when they stopped the supplements, the benefits were reversed. So this is something you always have to think about when you're using any kind of compound, whether it's a medication or a supplement. What will happen if you stop taking it? This actually lends support to the data set. It strengthens the result. But you know, if you stop taking it, the lipid profile might kind of go back to where it was. So this may be a long-term supplement if you want to help maintain a healthy lipid profile. So they started the supplement again, and the effect was replicated. So really strong data set, small study, but very convincing results. So in order for LDL to be disposed properly in the body, it requires the LDL receptor. So the LDL receptor binds LDL, and it's internalized and goes inside of the cell, it gets broken down. This is how the liver gets rid of LDL. There is one small problem with this. There's a protein called PCSK9, and that actually sits around and waits to bind to the LDL receptor, and it destroys it. So once it's destroyed, it can't go back up and be recycled and work again and again. And this reduces the amount of the LDL receptor that is available on the membrane to internalize LDL particles. There is new evidence that suggests that berberine modulates this process. It directly modulates PCSK9 and may thereby support the stability and abundance of LDL receptors at the membrane. And that is one of the key steps of proper disposal of LDL. It remains to be established whether you can get enough berberine into the body for it to do this, because the bioavailability of berberine can be as low as 1% or less. You might not be able to achieve this with doses commonly used. So there are probably other mechanisms at play if you're using the typical dose used in clinical trials. So this is basically a hypothesis, but it is an interesting one. There is a great proof of principle out there that PCSK9 inhibitors favorably affect lipid profiles. So by blocking PCSK9, you can actually enhance the number of LDL receptors that are at the membrane. If you're interested in this infographic, I will point to a resource at the end that you could check it out with a short article that goes into it. Another area of research on berberine involves the vasculature, and there are two components of vascular health that are worth mentioning here. First, the vascular smooth muscle cells. This is a compartment of the vasculature that most people might not be aware of, or it's not talked about as often as it should, because these smooth muscles regulate the thickness of the artery, and you want these muscle cells to maintain them their own normal shape and size, because once they become bigger, then the vascular thickness increases. So this is something you want to avoid. Anything that helps keep these smooth muscle cells in the proper shape and size is something that's desirable. And of course, many of you are probably familiar with endothelial health as a pillar of cardiovascular health. And berberine supports both of these. So in the vascular smooth muscle, berberine helps to attenuate the actions of growth factors that would normally cause these muscle cells to grow. It also helps to arrest the cell cycle of the muscle cells so that they are less likely to grow. So that is an interesting area of berberine in the vasculature. So one other area that is quite interesting is supporting nitric oxide synthesis in the actual endothelium. And just to refresh your memory, nitric oxide is made from arginine, which is an amino acid. It requires an enzyme to convert it to nitric oxide, and berberine may support that as well. And that may explain why, in this study, researchers found that berberine, when given at a dose of 1,200 milligrams per day for 1 month, significantly supported flow-mediated vasodilation. And this is a measurement of endothelial function. Largely, it's nitric oxide dependent. And they found that after the 1 month of supplementation, individuals who took berberine had significantly higher flow-mediated dilation than individuals in the control group. Some of the most compelling analysis of berberine and its efficacy comes from meta-analyses. This is a big meta-analysis of 27 RCTs involving over 2,500 patients, and it confirmed the safety and efficacy of berberine in supporting glucose homeostasis and maintaining lipid profiles. It was also more effective when combined with lifestyle interventions than when given as a supplement without any additional interventions. So as always, you want to combine berberine with a more comprehensive approach for best results. And that would include exercise, healthy diet, and so forth. Berberine was also safe and well tolerated according to this analysis. So the dose-limiting toxicities of berberine are mostly gastrointestinal in nature, but they are not very common. The lower doses around 1,000 milligrams per day are unlikely to cause that. You get into that when you approach 1,500 to 2,000 milligrams per day. So it's a dose-dependent, very transient, mild effect. If you have someone who has some GI issues already, you want to be cautious with berberine and just start with a low dose. So we've gone through the top three evidence-based indications for berberine. Clinical trials have administered 500 to 2,000 milligrams per day for 4 to 12 weeks. And the safe and effective and well-tolerated dose range is 900 to 1,500 milligrams per day. So that's a good range to just keep in mind. When you buy a supplement, that's the dose that you're looking for, especially because berberine bioavailability is very low, which we'll get to next. With enhanced bioavailable forms, you might be able to get away with a lower dose than that. Let's talk about how berberine works and some of its molecular targets. And much of this evidence is informed by that in vitro evidence base. So berberine supports the actions of AMPK. And AMPK is an enzyme that gets activated when we exercise, when we restrict calories. It's supporting the mitochondria. It helps to support the renewal of these mitochondrial networks. Supporting healthy aging, AMPK activation has numerous health benefits, and that's one of the primary targets for berberine. It supports AMPK. IRS1, this is a substrate that's attached to the insulin receptor. It helps the insulin receptor work better, and that is upregulated by berberine. PTP1B negatively regulates the insulin receptor, and berberine helps to modulate that. PCSK9, we just went through that. That is another target of berberine. NF-kappa-B, this orchestrates immune activation in response to inflammatory cytokines that's negatively regulated by berberine. And then NRF2, this is an antioxidant switch that regulates gene expression of phase 2 detoxification enzymes, superoxide dismutase, and other antioxidant enzymes. So I've listed the primary potential mechanisms of berberine. These six molecular targets are backed by fairly strong in vitro data and to some extent some animal data. So AMPK, just to refresh your memory or tell you a little bit more about what this really is, AMPK is an enzyme that supports the function of SIRT1, and that is a deacetylase enzyme that promotes PGC1 alpha activity, and that activates the biogenesis of mitochondria. Mitochondrial biogenesis is the synthesis of brand new mitochondria. The more mitochondria you have in a cell, generally the better the insulin receptors work in that cell. It's all connected. So supporting mitochondrial function indirectly supports insulin receptor function. And again, when the insulin receptor is working well, you have very efficient translocation of glucose transporter molecules to the cell surface. So that GLUT4, that's present in muscle cells, which are very insulin sensitive most of the time. This is one of the ways that you can support that entire process by activating this AMPK axis. And that's one of the things that berberine does. Berberine's not alone in this category. Caloric restriction does this as well. Metformin, resveratrol, alpha-lipoic acid, exercise, these all support this AMPK axis. Some of the things in the Western diet that negatively affect this process include a high-fat, high-sugar diet, inflammation, and aging also downregulates this process. If you're restricting calories, if you're exercising, this entire pathway is going to be upregulated. And supplementing with berberine is only going to help with that. IntegrativePharmacology.com, this is my website. There's an infographic there you can check out. Just a quick mention here of all of the different ways that you can support AMPK. Berberine is just one of them. So if you want to diversify any type of protocol that's aimed towards metabolic health, cardiometabolic health, healthy aging, This might be a useful way of kind of looking at what's available. Let's talk about the effect of berberine on the gut microbiome. This is very interesting because berberine absorption is so low, but it's so highly efficacious. And that low bioavailability, high efficacy paradox is endemic in the supplement space. And one of the leading hypotheses to explain why that is the fact that berberine is probably working in large part through a topical mechanism of action where in the gut, it's modifying the bacterial compositions. So to remind you, the gut microbiota play a huge role in human health. They're influenced by lifestyle factors, dietary factors, and changes in the microbiota change the number of signaling metabolites that are synthesized. And these are called postbiotics. Postbiotics include LPS, endotoxins, which generally have negative effects on metabolism. The beneficial ones include the short-chain fatty acids like butyrate. So these signaling metabolites can travel throughout the body. The short-chain fatty acids are small molecules easily distributed to other tissues, and they can support the functions of these other organ systems. So how does berberine affect the microbiome? Now, this is a complicated question, but studies have shown that berberine supports the enrichment of acromantia. And acromantia are a class of bacteria that support metabolic health, glucose responses, lipids, etc. And supporting this can have beneficial metabolic effects in humans. Berberine also supports the growth of short-chain fatty acid-producing bacteria, including the butyrogenic bacteria. And studies have also shown that it reduces other species that you might not want in high abundance. And it also supports the Bacteroides-Firmicutes ratio, which is also also directly linked to metabolic health. This is a recent study published in Biomedical Pharmacotherapy, and this showed that berberine supports acromantia growth. So acromantia requires this compound called mucin in order to survive and thrive in the gut. And they found that when mucin levels were high, acromantia growth was higher. So berberine promotes acromantia growth by stimulating the production of mucin, which is in blue. So they stained the cells for mucin, and you can see in the colon with berberine supplementation, this was in animals, the mucin levels were much higher. So compared to the what you see high-fat diet versus high-fat diet with berberine, there was an enrichment in mucin. There was also a significant increase in acromantia in the gut of animals given berberine. So the high-fat diet model is very common in animal research. It's a way of deregulating metabolism in a way that sort of recapitulates the Western diet. And they found that when giving berberine along with this high-fat diet, there was a beneficial effect on mucin production, acromantia populations. But berberine's mechanisms in the gut go far beyond this. So berberine supports the proliferation of bacteria that support short-chain fatty acid production. And short-chain fatty acids are sources of cellular energy for the gut. They support barrier integrity, microbial balance, and immunological homeostasis in the gut. Butyrate is probably the best known SFCA or short-chain fatty acid, and berberine levels of berberine directly supports healthy butyrate levels in the gut. Berberine also helps to maintain the immunological homeostasis in the gut, and one of those facets is the modulation of cytokine release. So cytokines can be released when the immune system gets activated. NF-kappa B is a target for berberine, and that allows berberine to kind of modulate the release of these immune mediators in the gut. Goblet cells create mucin, and mucin helps acromantia to grow. And acromantia supports glucose and insulin homeostasis. So that's another mechanism of action that involves the gut microbiome. And then finally, berberine supports barrier integrity. And barrier integrity involves the expression of tight junction proteins, reducing LPS-induced permeability, and supporting short-chain fatty acids, which indirectly support the barrier function itself. complicated array of local mechanisms in the gut, which may explain, you know, why huge increases in bioavailability may not be needed for berberine to work well. And on that subject, let's just go into the absorption, distribution, metabolism, and excretion, or pharmacokinetics of this compound. Less than 1% of an oral dose of berberine is typically absorbed. So obviously, this is an opportunity to create new technologies that enhance the absorption of this compound. The small amount of berberine that actually gets into the body typically goes to the lungs, liver, kidneys, muscle and fat cells, and brain, as well as the heart. When berberine gets into cells, especially cells in the liver and in the gut, a lot of it actually turns around and leaves. So this is actually a big problem with berberine bioavailability, and it's called efflux. There are these efflux pumps that see berberine, and they think that berberine is a toxin, so they just pump it right back out. The berberine that actually gets in is heavily metabolized by two P450 enzymes, CYP2D6 and CYP1A2, which create a precursor that gets conjugated by phase two enzymes, and that generates excretable metabolites that can leave via bile or urine. So berberine is up against quite a lot in getting distributed into the body and getting to cells that need it. The metabolites, however, may be highly biologically active. So notice that these are all metabolites of berberine. They're structurally very similar to berberine. Some of them may be more bioavailable than berberine. The dihydroberberine here doesn't have a charged nitrogen atom, and that allows it to cross membranes much more effectively than actual berberine. So these metabolites have great promise as possible ways to get around the poor bioavailability issue, or to just change the conversation and focus more on these metabolites and assessing the pharmacokinetics and the distribution of berberine to tissues. The microbiome is instrumental in the biotransformation of berberine to potentially active compounds as well. So there's a lot of redundancy between what the gut microbiome can do and, you know, what the human liver can do as far as turning berberine into these other compounds. But these reactions include oxidation, demethylation, reduction, and some of these compounds are more bioavailable than berberine. So again, these more bioavailable analogs might reach cells and tissues in different parts of the body more effectively than the parent compound. So we might be underestimating the bioavailability of berberine because we're missing these other compounds. But the fact remains that less than 1% is actually absorbed. And it's the berberine that hits those molecular targets like AMPK and that potassium channel and all those other unique molecular pathways. So it's ultimately berberine that we want to get into the body. It's what we want to get to the tissues and do what it's supposed to do. So whenever you take a dietary supplement, it would be ideal if it all got absorbed. What happens is, you know, this is just a fictitious situation, especially because the phytochemicals that we use in dietary supplements are sometimes perceived as toxins, even though they're not. Cells like to just pump them back out or not let them in the first place. Not letting them in the first place is something that membranes are really good at. Membranes are selective barriers that only allow certain things to cross. And in the GI tract, there are two membranes that a compound needs to get through, the apical and the basolateral membrane of that monolayer of cells. So berberine has a really hard time getting through that barrier. There's also a water layer that makes it difficult for berberine to effectively disperse. So these are some obstacles that berberine is up against just from the start. You can get around this in several ways. First, you can use one of the higher doses, a 1.5 gram dose per day, will increase systemic exposure. Analogs of berberine, that's another strategy. We won't go into it today. It's probably in the future of the dietary supplement space. There might be some ingredients popping up in the future that are analogs that might be better absorbed. But one mechanism of enhanced absorption that has already been proven is a phytosome. So phytosomes are these lipid vehicles that contain berberine in the polar head group of the phospholipid, and they allow berberine to cross membranes much more effectively. And there's clinical research showing that this definitely works. So a phytosome addresses the problem of a poorly absorbed compound in the gut by enclosing it in these phospholipids. And the berberine lives in this phospholipid head group, and it creates a particle that is very easy to disperse. It actually crosses membranes, it crosses through that water layer, and it enhances the absorption. It's pretty simple. It's just a lipid delivery vehicle that has profound effects on the absorption profile, as shown here. So in the open squares, we have standard berberine. This is a human pharmacokinetic study. Standard berberine, 500 milligrams of this phytosome, and comparing that with a phytosome at two different doses, 550 and 1,000 milligrams, and the enhancement in the area under the curve, which is a measure of oral bioavailability in humans, was increased fourfold with the phytosome at the same dose. And then when they doubled that dose, there was a tenfold increase in oral bioavailability. So clearly the phytosome is an excellent way to overcome the bioavailability limitation of berberine. Phytosomes are excellent vehicles for addressing some of the common limitations that natural products have in getting into the body and getting to where they need to go. The pros include increasing the solubility, the permeation, enhancing digestive stability of the compound. They are very small particles, which enhances the uptake through the GI tract, and they're very stable. The only cons are confirmation of efficacy. Really, you have to look at the clinical research to see whether that phytosome is producing the benefit that you're trying to achieve in a patient. In the case of berberine, yes, there is a study that shows that it supports healthy glucose responses in humans. Price point might be higher, but keep in mind, with this fourfold enhancement of bioavailability, that may be entirely worthwhile. So let's talk about that study on the phytosome. This was a single-arm pilot trial of 12 women, and they received 1,100 milligrams of the berberine phytosome per day for 2 months. And they found that there was significant support for healthy glucose responses and glucose homeostasis, which corroborates all the other evidence on berberine without the phytosome. But this was a lower dose than a lot of the studies that you would typically see. There were also favorable changes in these immune mediators, TNF-alpha, CRP, or C-reactive protein, and the clinical efficacy was demonstrated after only 30 days. So that was it's always good to see a study that's short, that way after a 30-day trial, reevaluate glucose and related parameters and see if the supplement is working. There were no GI side effects, so that's reassuring. That's always something you want to check on. But berberine phytosome is extremely well tolerated. So I want to end with some safety notes and drug interactions. Fortunately, with regard to safety, there's nothing remarkable to comment on here. Excellent safety record, generally well tolerated, doses up to 1,500 milligrams per day. You typically want to divide that into multiple doses. With 1,500 milligrams a day, most of the time in the studies, the protocol is 500 milligrams 3 times daily. Mild GI side effects have been reported with a prevalence of up to 35% of participants in a given clinical trial. So the range of GI side effects is 0 to about 35% of subjects. Again, with the phytosome, there were no GI side effects. Potential drug interactions include the P450 enzymes that berberine is both a substrate for and also can inhibit. CYP3A4 is directly bound by berberine, at least in cell culture. CYP3A4 lives in the gut, so you don't need an excellent absorption profile to inhibit this enzyme. CYP3A4 metabolizes more than half of all medications that are prescribed, at least in the US. And clinical evidence does prove that this interaction is clinically significant for cyclosporine and midazolam, or Versed. Theoretically, you could get interactions that go far beyond this because of the range of drugs that 3A4 actually metabolizes, but the absorption and bioavailability of berberine is low, And the amount that you would need to inhibit that enzyme is actually quite high. So theoretically, it actually is unlikely to interact with a lot of these other drugs metabolized by that enzyme. CYP2D6 metabolizes dextromethorphan and some other commonly used drugs. This is mainly significant for dextromethorphan. We just don't know whether it really pertains to other CYP2D6 substrates. And then finally, losartan, which is a commonly used drug for hypertension. Berberine reduces levels of this drug in the plasma, which may make the drug less effective in managing hypertension. So that's something you want to be cautious with. You might not have to avoid berberine, but if you are using berberine and losartan at the same time, make sure that you read blood pressure and detect any changes because it could make the drug less effective. Glucose-lowering drugs could theoretically interact with berberine and produce an additive or possibly synergistic drop in glucose, but so far there really isn't any evidence that this is an actual safety concern. And with antihypertensive medications, same premise. Because of the effect of berberine on the endothelium, theoretically you could get an additive effect or maybe a synergistic effect with the antihypertensive medications. But you know whether berberine actually does interact with the 300 plus different antihypertensives that are FDA approved, we simply don't know. And theoretically, it's actually quite unlikely. So berberine also inhibits P glycoprotein, which kicks a lot of drugs out of cells. It inhibits P450s. It's possible that berberine could interact with a lot of drugs, but the research is currently too immature to be able to provide any strong statements about what to avoid. These are just guidelines that are based on the available knowledge that we have. So let's summarize what we've gone through today. First, berberine has extensive evidence supporting its use for cardiometabolic applications, glucose, lipids, and vascular health. It's safe and effective at doses of 900 milligrams to 1500 milligrams per day. AMPK and the microbiome are two of the predominant mechanisms by which berberine executes these beneficial cardiometabolic effects. The poor bioavailability of berberine can be improved through a variety of methods, but phytosomes appear to be the leading method of enhancing the systemic exposure to this compound. If you want to read more, I highly recommend you refresh your PubMed skills. And here's just a quick tip for you. When you're in a rush and you want to download a few good papers and read a little bit, I highly recommend just going to PubMed, typing the compound into the search box in brackets, include titles so you get a more specific search output, and then filter for clinical trials, and then filter for the last 5 years. So if you do this, you will narrow down all that literature to 30 papers, and 50% of those papers are open access in this case. If you have time to just check, kind of play around and look at the evidence, even by just skimming the abstracts, this is the single best way you can learn about new ingredients. So I want to thank you for your attention. I'll point to Berberine Ultrasorb. This is a new product with that phytosome that I described. So if you want more information about that, feel free to contact us. I also want to draw your attention to this free online course on the integration of pharmaceuticals and natural products in cardiometabolic care. This is a complimentary course that I created. There is a link at integrativepharmacology.com. You can also download several articles that go into more depth about some of the concepts I've talked about today. If you're interested in how to compare oral bioavailability between different dietary supplements, if this is an area that confuses you and you're not really sure how to select the right supplement, I create a very short course on how to do this. So feel free to access this as well. So again, thank you for your attention, and I'll take any questions.